So that's clear. So we had the sort of two views, quite different. Olivier, you're not a centrist, but your role is to sort of...
Yeah, exactly. I find myself, not surprisingly, in between. There's a lot of space between the two, so it's easy to be in between. I think the euro has real problems that Jean-Claude did not emphasize, that Ashok overemphasized. I think they can be alleviated. I don't think they can be eliminated. I've organized my remarks in 7 points. I'll try to stick to that. So the first one is, remember the remark about the democracy being the best of all bad systems. I think it's the same thing for the euro. I think that for the countries, at least for most of the members, maybe not all, the euro is the least bad of the monetary and exchange rate arrangements. Again, maybe the footnote, maybe some members might be better off out, but let's leave this aside. The reason I say this is that we tried other ways before. We tried the soft peg, we tried the hard peg, it didn't work so good. So what's left is floating, which would be difficult to manage given the depth of the financial market. And I think that floating between Germany and France is a non-starter at this point. I just don't see it. So it seems to me we have to accept the fact that there is no, we know that, that there is no good or perfect monetary system or exchange rate arrangement, but this is probably the best we can get. So we better make the best of it. So second point. So what is it that I think doesn't work very well? Why is it that the euro is not functioning perfectly? It's due to and the original sin, and Ashok mentioned that, and Mondale gave conditions for an optimal currency area, and it's fairly clear that on its face, the euro just did not satisfy those conditions, right? So either you need all the countries to have the same shocks, which we found that is not the case, or you need a lot of mobility of factors so that when one country does poorly, people move to the other, and there are limits to this when people don't speak the same language. And so the only thing which is left is that when you have a shock, you have to have an adjustment of competitiveness, you have to have an adjustment of relative prices, and that is what is not working well. When Ashok refers to the inability of Italy to depreciate, it could in principle do it at a fixed exchange rate within the euro, but it would have to decrease prices and wages. And that's what's not happening. So I think that's the source of the problem. Again, Europe has many other problems and they interact with this, but this one is, I think, the implication of the euro itself. So the third point is, why is it so bad? Well, we know, and we've seen it now. We've seen it in two ways. First, we saw the very large current account deficits of the countries in the south, be it Greece, be it Portugal, be it Spain, and how dangerous it was, both because it would come to an end naturally or it could create a sudden stop, and we saw that. So we saw that when you cannot adjust your relative price and you run very large current account deficits, then you run into trouble. Now we're seeing the opposite. We're seeing basically an enormous German current account surplus. Now it's a bit of a different beast because you can sustain the surplus more or less forever, but it is not a good idea from your point of view, but it is something which affects the others, and basically other things equal, the current account surplus of Germany is leading to a euro appreciation, which is clearly affecting other countries, and has all kinds of other effects, which I will not discuss. So, the lack of adjustment of prices and wages has major implications. As I said, we know these implications can basically determine politics, and we're seeing this. So the question is, what is it? So if we take this as the issue, why is it that the adjustment is so low, so slow, so difficult? And so that's my fourth point, which is very short. I think there are two reasons. The first one is that not all countries play by the rules. And I'll come back to Germany. I think it is not playing by the rules of the euro, and that's an important point. Then the other is, even when they play by the rules, you have a very slow response of prices and wages to the labor market, and as a result, you have a long period, in the case of current account deficits, of high unemployment, and that, again, politically, humanly, politically, it is very costly. So let me now turn to rules and then to the slow response. So rules is my fifth point. What are the rules? The rules of the game is that countries which have current account surpluses should basically have prices increase faster than the average, so they should have more inflation than the average. And if they refuse to do that, either for contractionary fiscal policy or other means, then the other countries cannot adjust. And that's exactly what we're seeing in Germany, where you have contractionary fiscal policy limiting the amount of inflation and making the adjustment impossible. This is not respecting the rules. I mean, if somebody needs to decrease their prices below the others have to accept a higher price than the average. So I think that that is a big issue, and that's something which should be addressed and can be addressed under the existing institutions. But Germany has to understand that what is good for the euro, and is actually good for Germany, should be allowed to happen. So higher inflation in Germany is both for Germany and for the euro essential. On the slow response of wages and prices, I have about 1 or 2 minutes. I think there are two reasons. The first one is when the average inflation rate in the euro is low and you need to have less inflation in order to improve, it's very difficult. You may have to have cuts in wages, nominal wages, and this is extremely difficult to achieve. People do not like cuts in wages, and indeed you see that it doesn't happen, so you don't get the adjustment. So that's an issue for the ECB. The second, which is something that I care very much about at this point, is the lack of trust between social partners in many countries. In many countries, what's needed is a decrease in wages and prices, which would lead to a very small decrease in real wages. Some, but not much. It could be achieved if the partners understood without the unemployment. They do not agree, and as a result, what happens is you have a long period of unemployment which forces the same outcome, but with 5 or 10 years of hardship. And here it seems to me that that's at the level of countries, I'm thinking of my own, in France, the level of discussions between the social partners is extremely poor. It used to be much better under indicative planning in the old days, where the partners would sit down and see what could be done, and then they agreed or they did not agree, but at least they discussed the issues. It's not happening. So I just conclude, what would I do? Higher inflation at the euro level, I would love more than 2%, but I accept 2%, I want 2% at least. Respect for the rules in the case of Germany, and the other countries, but Germany in this case, improvement in labor relations, which is a national issue. Let me end there and mention one issue I did not discuss, because I do not think it's an essential reform, is fiscal union. I fully agree with Jean-Claude about the banking union, capital markets union, but I don't think the fiscal union is an essential part of the solution.
Good. Thank you, and thanks for sticking to the time to all three.